him glory, give him honor, give him adoration. We bless you, mighty God. We give you praise, we give you honor. We thank you. We bless you. We give you praise. We give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we celebrate you tonight. Thank you, Lord of glory. In Jesus' precious name, please clap your hands for the King of Kings. Hallelujah!
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Please, you may be seated. And as you're sitting down, wave at somebody and tell them you are welcome to the house of the Lord. Glory be to God. I said, glory be to God. Somebody shout hallelujah. Lift your right hand and shout, I love you, Jesus. How many love him? Wave at him and say, I love you, Jesus. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 13 and verse number 8 happens to be our anchor passage where the Bible says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we seem to be stuck, first of all, with just the name itself, Jesus Christ. Amen? Before we look at the rest of the verse that talks about him being the same yesterday, today, and forever, we want to discuss him first. Praise the Lord. So I'm speaking on the subject, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, hallelujah. The Master is known by many names, and each and every of those names reveals an aspect of his nature, his character, or his works. An aspect of his nature, his manner, his character, or indeed his mission, his work. And I want us to look at Acts chapter 2 and verse number 36 here. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. It says, the Lord God of heaven has made Jesus both Lord and Christ. And tonight I want us to have some good study on the Lordship of Jesus. In the first service, we looked at him as the Christ, meaning the anointed one. But now we want to look at him as Lord. Somebody shout, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is
Lord. Yes, he is. Jesus Christ is Lord. And please understand this important truth about our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is Lord. Say that with me. Jesus Christ is Lord. Peter says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know. You see, it has to be known. He says, let the whole house of Israel know assuredly. There is nothing to doubt about this. This is a definite, perfect arrangement that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Jesus is Lord. Whether somebody likes it or not, Jesus has been made by God to be Lord. Somebody shout, Jesus,
Jesus
is Lord.
Lord.
Now, what is to be Lord? When we say that someone is Lord, in this case, Jesus has been made Lord, what does Lord mean? A Lord, when we say that someone is Lord, it means that he is an owner. A Lord is an owner. A Lord is a master. A master. So when we say that Jesus is Lord, it means Jesus is the owner. The owner. And we'll be looking at what he is the owner of. When we say that Jesus is Lord, we also mean that he is the master. When we say that someone is Lord, it means we are talking about someone who is in charge. To be Lord is to be in charge. To be an owner, to be a master, to be in charge. To be Lord also means to be a ruler. To be a ruler. To be Lord may also mean to be in absolute authority. Absolute authority. Absolute authority. To be Lord also means to be a final decision maker. A final decision maker. Praise the name of Jesus. Now, we are talking about God making Jesus Lord. He has been made Lord. God, it pleased God the Father to make Jesus Lord. And so I want us to quickly here discuss what I'm calling dimensions of Jesus's lordship. Dimensions of Jesus's lordship. Number one, he is Lord over creation. Jesus is Lord over creation. As a matter of fact, he is the reason for all creation. He is the reason. Jesus is the reason for all creation. I mean, let us look at Colossians chapter 1. I mean, I will be giving you all kinds of scriptures tonight in this service because I want us to have some good Bible study. Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 to 17. The Bible says he has delivered us, meaning God has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Verse 15. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Jesus is the firstborn over all creation. There was no creation before him. For by him, hear this, verse 16, for by him all things were created. By who? By Jesus. All things that were created by who? By Jesus. For by him all things were created. Which things? Things that are in heaven and things that are on earth. What things? Visible and invisible things. What things? Whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things, hear this, were created through him and for him. How many things? All. Now, John put it this way in John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. You remember, if you look at that, in that verse number 1, you see that he's using capital W for Word. Meaning, he's not just talking about words as in letters. No, he's talking about a person. Praise the name of Jesus. He's talking about a person because when you look at this discourse in verse number 14, what does he say? He says, and the Word, capital W, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So you know he's talking about a person, and his name is Jesus. Now let's get back to verse number 1. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 2, now hear this. He was in the beginning with God. So he's using he to talk about the Word. He's talking about Jesus. Now hear this. Verse number 3. It says, all things were made through him. And without him, nothing was made that was made. That is why I'm concluding that Jesus is Lord over all creation. He's a master over all creation. He's the ruler over all creation. He is the owner of all creation. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. Say it better, hallelujah. The Bible speaking in Psalm 148, verses 1 to 5. I'm looking for verse 5, but let's begin from verse number 1. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you stars of light. Praise him, you heavens of heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Verse number 5. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were what? Created. And God has made this Jesus to be what? Lord. Says, let them praise the name of the Lord. Why? Because he commanded and they were created. He is Lord over all creation. That is why during his earthly ministry, Jesus silenced elements of nature that wanted to give him problems. For example, Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41, he tells his disciples, let us cross over to the other side. And they did start off in obedience to that instruction. And in verse number 37, the Bible says, a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling. I think the idea was to drown them. But what did the Lord of all creation do? Look at verse number 39. The Bible says that Jesus arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace be still. And the sea answered back. Huh? Did the sea answer back? Because when the wind and the waves heard the voice, they recognized the voice. They said, this is the Lord's voice. We better keep quiet. And so the Bible says, and the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Praise the name of Jesus. The same thing in Mark chapter 11, verses 12 to 14, the master woke up without breakfast that morning, and so he was hungry, the Bible tells us. And in verse number 13, the Bible says that he saw from afar a fig tree having leaves. He went to see if perhaps he would find something on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. I think he was a bit disappointed. So what did he do? Look at the next verse. In response, Jesus said to it, "Let no one eat fruit from you ever again." And the Bible says his disciples held it. In other words, I declare you dead. What happened? Verse number 20. The Bible says, now in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. He is Lord over creation. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say it better, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And that is why the Bible does tell us in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 10, 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 10 now, that a day is coming, oh my God, when the elements of the earth will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be what? Burnt up. He has that capacity. He's the Lord of all, the Lord over all creation. He says, a day is coming. It is called the day of the Lord, when this earth will burn like an oven, and all the works that are in it will be burnt up. That will be the final blow on the earth as the exercise of his lordship over creation. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, dimensions of Christ's lordship. Number one, he is Lord over creation. Number two, hear this. He is Lord over the devil and his demons.
Amen.
Jesus is Lord over the devil and his demons. And I'm telling you, the devil is not happy that I'm telling you this. Especially the second one. Jesus, somebody shout with me, Jesus
is Lord
over the devil
and his demons.
Why? Because, now hear this, Jesus is a creator while the devil is a creature. Colossians 1, verse number 16. You remember we read that verse. Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 16. For by him all things were created. All things, including Satan. Satan is inside there. He's in the all things. So whether you are looking at what? He says thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All these were created by Jesus. All these were created by Jesus. Jesus is Lord over the devil and his demons. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23, we may not have time to read all those verses, but please give me verse 19. Give me verse 19. Says that you may know what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. Next verse. Which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. Now hear this. It says when God raised Christ from the dead, he sat him at his right hand. Where? In the heavenly places. Where is Jesus sitting? At the right hand of the Father in the heavenly places. Somebody shout, Jesus is seated at God's right hand in the heavenly places. Now, where are these heavenly places? Next verse, verse 21. It says, they are far above. Far above what? All principality and power and might and dominion and far above every name that is named, including the devil's name. Is it making sense?
Yes.
And every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. Somebody shout hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. He exercises lordship over the devil and his demons, over Satan and his evil spirits. And so it is not surprising, therefore, that Apostle Paul does tell us in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 to 11, Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 to 11, that God has highly exalted Jesus and given him the name which is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth. Look at that. Those in heaven, those on earth, and those under the earth. Where else can you be? If you are not in heaven, you must be on the earth. If you are not on earth, you must be under the earth. There is no other place to be. So anything and everything that is found in heaven, found on earth, found under the earth, must bow the knee at the name of Jesus. You see, you have nothing to fear in this world. Yes. Say that with me. Lift your right hand and say, I have nothing to fear in this world.
I have nothing to fear in this world.
Say it louder. I have nothing to fear in this world.
I have nothing to fear in this world.
Because Christ in you is the hope of glory. And at the mention of his name, every knee must bow of the things in heaven and of the things on earth and of the things under the earth. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That is why the master gave us the power of attorney to use his name here on earth. He gave us the right to use his name for our victories here on earth. Mark 16 and verse 17. He gave us the right to his name, to use his name. And these signs will follow those who believe. Now hear this. He said, in my name, they will cast out demons. And demons have no choice but to vamoose, to vacate, to leave immediately. We have the right to expel demons from people's lives, from places, homes, communities. We have the right to use the name of Jesus to expel demons wherever they are found. Because our Lord Jesus Christ is master over the devil and his demons. I want to show you some more on this. Colossians chapter 2 verse 15. Give it to me in NIV. Colossians chapter 2 and verse number 15. The Bible says, having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. What are these powers and authorities? These are demonic structures, demonic powers, demonic authorities. He's talking about the devil and his court. He says Jesus disarmed them. They don't have arms anymore. Their arms, their weaponry, their artillery was taken away by the master on the cross. On the cross, on the cross. The Bible says he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. triumphing over them by the cross. Let's look at this verse from the Amplified version. Amplified. God disarmed principalities and powers that were arranged against us and made a bold display and public example of them in triumphing over them in him and in it, meaning the cross. That is why Jesus could not be crucified in the valley. He had to be crucified on the mountain. Hallelujah. Where he had to be hung. He was already on a raised place, but on that raised place, they had to put him on the cross, so he was high up. Hallelujah. To make a public spectacle of the devil and his demons. To tell the world that I have defeated him. He's a defeated foe. He's a defeated enemy. I said, Satan is a defeated enemy. I said, he's a defeated enemy. I said, he's a defeated enemy. Somebody shout, Jesus is Lord over the devil and his demons. Yes. Glory to God. Now look at this. Two more scriptures very quickly, if not three. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 14. Give us in any version. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself, meaning Jesus, likewise, shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. Have you seen that? Jesus destroyed him who had the power of death. And who had the power of death? The devil. Who had the power of death? Who had the power of death? And what did Jesus do to him who had the power of death? He destroyed him. Now, that does not mean, oh my God, that does not mean that the devil is extinct. That does not mean that devil does not exist anymore. Is it making sense? So what does the word destroy mean? What does the word destroy mean? The word destroy means render powerless. To destroy means to render powerless. Amen? To destroy also means to reduce to zero. To reduce to zero. The word destroy also means to bring to nothing. Have I already talked about that? To bring to nothing. To bring to nothing. It also means to paralyze. To paralyze. To render ineffective. In other words, if you are a believer, you can live a successful life despite the devil. You can live a victorious life despite the existence of the devil, because Jesus destroyed him. Hallelujah. The Bible says he was disarmed. The weaponry he had was taken away from him. You know what the master says in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 18. Revelation chapter 1. And verse 18, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Jesus is alive for how long, sir? Forevermore. Because if you look at Romans chapter 6, verse 9, before we finish reading this, let's go to Romans chapter 6 and verse number 9. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Says, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Why? Death no longer has dominion over him.
Amen.
So let's get back to Revelation 1 and verse number 18. He says, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. He says, I have the keys of Hades and of death. Who is keeping the keys? I mean, the one who has the keys is the one who has the final say. No matter how badly you want to enter your house, if I am the one keeping your keys, sir, you will not enter. You will not enter, sir. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. It says Jesus has got what? The keys of Hades and death. They are with Jesus. That is how helpless the devil is by what Jesus did to him on the cross. As if that is not enough. 1 John 3:8 says, he who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. Now hear this. It says, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Why did Jesus come? It says, to destroy. Not only, remember, he destroyed the devil himself, but now he is also destroying what? The works. It's talking about sickness, disease, poverty, premature death, all kinds of demonic works. Jesus destroyed them. He rendered them powerless. That day you receive Jesus is the day the devil's license to oppress you expired. Sir, if he's keeping any license in his hand to oppress you, it is an expired license. And it is illegal to operate using an expired what? License. Jesus is Lord. Say that with me. Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
Over the devil.
Over the
and his demons. The meaning is, because Christ lives in you, if you meet him anywhere, you meet Satan anywhere or any of his demons anywhere trying to cause havoc, you say, in the name of Jesus, shut up. They must what? Shut up. Because you have been given the right, the legal authority to use the name of Jesus. He said, in my name. Use my name. Use my name, because my name is far above every other name. Use my name. Praise the name of Jesus. I said, praise the name of Jesus. So, let's look at this. 1 John 4:4. 1 John 4:4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them. You have overcome them. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Who is in the world? The devil. He's called the god of this world. He says, the one who is in you, Colossians 1:27, Christ in you. Christ is in you. Christ is in you. Now, it says, he who is in you. Okay, yeah. Christ is in us, the hope of glory. But let's get back there to that verse. 1 John 4:4. It says, he who is in you, Christ Jesus who is in you, is greater than the devil who is in the world. Than the Antichrist who is in the world. Than the son of Belial who is in the world. You are greater. It says, Jesus is greater. Now, because Christ is in you, then you sit above the devil.
Amen.
Because of Christ who is in you, where do you sit? Above. You people, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes.
Let's look at Ephesians 2:6 here. Ephesians 2:6. Okay, let's start from verse number, let's appreciate the context. Verse number 3. Among whom also, okay, verse number 4. Now, it says, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive. What did Jesus, what did the Father do? He made us alive. Together with who? With Christ. He made us alive. Somebody shout, I am alive. I want you to say it this way. The Father has made me alive. Together with Christ. What else has the Father done? Verse number 6. It says, and has raised us up together with Christ. And has made us sit together with Christ in the heavenly places. Where are you sitting? No, you are not just sitting in area 49. In Christ Jesus, you are seated with the Father in heavenly places. In heavenly places. Where are these heavenly places? Let's get back to Ephesians chapter 1, because I want you to understand this. Ephesians chapter 1, you remember we're in verse 21. Verse 21. Glory to God. It says that the heavenly places, let's get back to verse 20, because after God raised Christ from the dead, he sat him at his right hand. Where? 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 And where are you seated together with Christ? And where are these heavenly places? Verse number 21, if you can read, everybody, 1, 2, go. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. Far! You are sitting far above the devil. Far, far. Sir, it is far. Far is already good enough, but it says far above, far, where he cannot reach you, sir. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Somebody say with me, Jesus is Lord over all creation. Number 2, you are going to say, Jesus is Lord over the devil and his demons. Number 3, dimensions of the Lordship of Jesus. Number 3, he is Lord over situations of life. He is Lord over situations of life. Jesus is Lord over situations of life. Amen. And these situations of life, in the interest of time, are summarized in Acts chapter 10 and verse number 38 and Luke chapter 4 verses 18 to 19. Now, in Acts chapter 10 and verse number 38, the Bible talks about how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing, hear this, all who were oppressed by the devil. Difficult situations of life are nothing but oppressions of the devil. Behind every evil, there is someone. His name is the devil. His name is called what? The devil. You just remove D there, you remain with what? Evil. Behind every evil, there is someone, and his name is the devil. And Jesus has capacity to heal all who are oppressed by the devil. Poverty is an oppression of the devil. Sickness and disease is an oppression of the devil. Marital struggle is an oppression of the devil. Barrenness is an oppression of the devil. It's an oppression of the devil. Amen. Jesus is Lord over situations of life. Situations like sickness and disease. You remember the Bible says during his earthly ministry that he healed every sickness and every disease among the people. Matthew 9:35. He healed every sickness and every disease among the people. Now, it also says, hear this, he healed all kinds of sickness. In case you don't understand this one. And all kinds of disease among the people. Matthew 4:23. He healed all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. Jesus. He's Lord of the situations. In John 6:1-15, give me verse 6. John 6:1-15. Then Jesus, hear this, lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him. What did he see? A great multitude coming toward him. And then the Bible says, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? There was a situation of hunger. They didn't have what to eat. So the question is, where do we get bread? Actually, to show that he's not stranded, he says, where shall we buy bread? That means there was money. There was what? Money to buy bread. I decree in this life, you shall always have money to buy bread. In the name of Jesus Christ. You shall always have what to eat in the name of Jesus. None of you and none of your children shall be a beggar of bread in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, the next verse tells us why he had to ask him this question. Now, hear this. But he said this to test Philip, for he himself knew what he would do. You see, Jesus knows what to do about your situation. He's Lord over situations. I said, Jesus is Lord over situations. I said, Jesus is Lord over situations. I said, Jesus is Lord over situations. He exercised mastery over this situation of need. And just from 2 loaves of bread and 5 fish. Is it 5 loaves of bread or 2 fish? Which is which? 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Thousands of people were fed. From 5 loaves and 2 fish, thousands were fed. Thousands were fed. And this Jesus is the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. I don't know what your situation is. I declare divine intervention. I said I declare divine intervention. I declare divine intervention. Whether you are in this room or you are watching me online, It doesn't matter what your situation is. I declare divine intervention. I said I declare divine intervention. I declare divine intervention. You may be seated. Glory be to God. I said glory be to God. He is Lord over all situations of life. Whether you're looking at poverty, he became poor. That we through his poverty may become rich. Yes. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse number 9. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse number 8, you just transpose the verses 8, 9 and 9, 8. It says, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always, oh my God, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. Can you imagine that God says to us through this verse that we can reach a stage in our lives by his grace where we will always have all sufficiency in all things? I better believe the word of God than fall for anybody's looks. He says, we, by his grace, that God is able to make abound to us, we can have always sufficiency in all things. That means there is no need that God cannot handle in your life. There's no situation too difficult for him. Please, don't squeeze your face as if there is no solution to your matter. You know what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 13? 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 13. The Bible says, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation, we also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. That means there is always going to be a way out of any kind of situation. Yes. Any kind. That's why I'm saying, don't squeeze your face. As if to tell God that I know what you can do, but my own is special. I don't think you can handle mine. Never. Never. There is no situation that God cannot handle in your life. There is no need that God cannot meet. God is never in need. He only meets needs. God is never in need. He only meets needs. Now, the Bible says in 1 Peter 5 and verse number 7, it says, casting your care upon him. Have you seen that? For he cares for you. Give it to us in NIV. Casting all your anxiety. So the first care is to do with what? Anxieties, worries, concerns. You know, some people have got many concerns. Pastor, I need 3 minutes of your time. They mean 3 hours. Because they have many concerns. So he says, cast your anxiety on him. Why? He is able to deal with any kind of anxiety. He is able. And then he says, because he cares for you. Now that second care, cares for you, means to anticipate a need and meet it. To anticipate a need, meaning the need has not arrived yet, but you are already ready for anything that may show up. For example, responsible parents like me, who has a child who goes to school. All right? Now, I anticipate a need to say that this child will be going back to school next term. So let me put money aside. So that when the need comes, I get the money to meet it. That is what God does with you, my friend. So listen to me. From today, there shall be no need that shall confuse you in life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I said in the mighty name of Jesus. Please, can I hear a loud shout of amen? So we can as well say, oh my God, that in Christ Jesus, we have no need. Because all our needs have already been met. In Christ Jesus, we have no what? No need. Because all that we need is already available in Christ. So don't be need conscious. Don't have a needy mentality. Don't have a what? A need mentality or needy mentality. I am a needy accountant. I am a needy pastor. So when members are greeting you, you are squeezing your face. As if to tell the member, can't you see my face is squeezed? Give me money now. I need some form of love offering. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Ask your neighbor, are you getting the message? Well, beloved, we have a long way to go. So can we move to number four now? Dimensions of Christ's Lordship. Number one, he is Lord over all creation. Number two, he is Lord over the devil and his demons. Number three, he is Lord over situations of life. Lord over oppressions of the devil. Number four, he is Lord, hear this, over the church. Jesus is Lord over the church. Jesus is Lord over the church. He is the master of the church. The owner of the church. You know what he said in that Matthew chapter 16 and verse number 18? Matthew chapter 16 and verse number 18. Oh my God. And I also said to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Whose church is it? Whose church is it? Is it the pastor's church? Huh? Is it the chief apostle's church? Who is the owner of the church? I will build my church. It is his church. He is the master of the church. He is head over the church. Jesus is head over the church. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 23. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 23. He says, we have come to the general assembly. He says, we have now. For you to appreciate the context here, can we start from verse 20? 20, let's check 20. Verse 21. So terrifying. Now, he's making a contrast here. I think you need to start much, much earlier. He says, we that are in Christ Jesus have not come to Mount Sinai. Now, it says, you have not come to the mountain that may be touched. Because Mount Sinai, you could actually see it. It is there. It says, we that are in Christ Jesus, we have not come to the mountain that may be touched. A mountain that burnt with fire. And to blackness and darkness and tempest. These are the things that the children of Israel saw on Mount Sinai when God came down. He says, we've not come to such kind of a mountain. No. Verse number 19. He says, and we have not come to the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who held it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. They said, Moses, hear on our behalf. And then you tell us what the Lord is saying. So Moses was a man of, thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord, because he was the only one hearing from God. Verse 20 says, for they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow. These are the rules that Moses was given, that I've set a boundary here. Anybody who crosses here will die instantly. So the writer of the book of Hebrews says, gentlemen, actually, I think he's using the word brethren, but allow me to use gentlemen and women, brothers and sisters, or you like saints. Saints. Says, saints, we have not come to such kind of a mountain. No. Verse number 21. So terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I am exceedingly afraid and trembling. Even Moses shook. He says, we've not come to the mountain of fears and intimidation. No. Verse 22. But he says, you have come to Mount Zion. Says, and to the city of the living God. You have come to the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to an innumerable company of angels. Like we are sitting here, angels are in abundance. I may not need to see them, but they are here because the Bible says so. It's not about feelings and seeings. Did you hear what I said? It's not about feelings and seeings. It's about what the Bible says. It says we have come to the city of the living God. We are not trying to come there, sir. We are there. The church of the living God is called the city of the living God. It says you have come to the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to an innumerable company of angels. Verse 23. Now hear this. It says you have come to the general assembly. So in this assembly, you don't have to feel lonely. No. There are many brothers you can befriend. Many sisters you can. Why should you be lonely in a general assembly? It says, now hear this. It says, and you have come to the church of the firstborn, who are registered in heaven. Says you have come to the church of the firstborn. Amen. This is what made me to read from verse 18, because I wanted you to appreciate the context. Says you that are in Christ Jesus have come to the church of the firstborn. Who is this firstborn? Jesus. So the church is called the, who is the owner? The firstborn. That is the owner of the church. Don't misbehave in the church in the name of it is Pastor Esau Banda's church. You goof. Sister, where do you worship? I worship at Pastor Esau Banda's church. That's an abuse of mouth. Because Pastor Esau Banda has never owned any church. It's an abuse of teeth. An abuse of air. I worship at Pastor Esau Banda's church. Who told you that? Are you a Christian? Don't you read your Bible? Don't you believe that the church belongs to the firstborn? Hallelujah. Why can't you tell people that I worship at PICs? Never you say again, I worship at Pastor Esau Banda's church. Because I have never owned any church. And some people misbehave in the church in the name of it is his church. So I have come to disturb it. You will be killed in no time. Yes. If you are not careful, there will be no old man in your father's house. All people will be dying young because you have decided to attack and to fight against the church. Be careful. When you say anything like that, people say, why are you intimidating? You're intimidating us. Oh. If people are told the truth, they call it what? Intimidation. It's intimidation. They're intimidating us. They don't want us to be speaking in the church. Now look at this. 1 Timothy 3:15. What else is the church called? 1 Timothy 3 and verse 15. Oh my God. But if I am delayed, this is Paul writing to Timothy, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God. The church of God is called what? The house of God. The church has an owner. God is the owner. The firstborn, Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, says that you may know how to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God. It is called what? The church of the living God. It is also called what? The pillar and ground of the truth. That is why in this church, we made up our minds to only tell the truth. You don't like it, you go. You like it, you stay. We are only telling people the truth. We tell it raw as we see it in the scriptures. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Some people say, Pastor, you are too straight. If I'm not straight, you want me to be what? Crooked. Have you seen that the church does not belong to the pastor? It is called the church of who? The church of the living God. It is called the house of God. Now, please, what does Jesus do as Lord over his church? Can we look at that? How many are enjoying this Bible study? Okay. Now, what does Jesus do as Lord over his church? Please, I want us to quickly look at four of these before we move on to look at other dimensions of his lordship. Number one, he builds his church. Yes. He builds his church. Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, we looked at it. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18. He said, on this rock I will build my church. Who is building the church? Jesus. Yes. Jesus is the one building his church. That is why his church, no matter what happens, check those of you that are students of Bible history, you will discover that attempts have been made over the ages to destroy the church. But every time those attempts have been made, the church has ended up shooting up, blossoming. You see, in Exodus now, talking about the children of Israel, Exodus chapter 1, verse number 7. Exodus chapter 1, just to digress a bit. The Bible says that the children of Israel were fruitful. Have you seen that? And increased abundantly and multiplied and grew exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. Have you seen that? Now, let's look at verse number 6. Everyone read that verse. And Joseph died, all his brothers and all that generation. Now, that's not good news. All the pillars, the fathers have died. Everybody. Verse number 7. Despite verse number 6, but the children of Israel were what? Fruitful. That's the church. No matter what you do with it, you see, the church, can I say this to you? The church thrives in adversity. The church thrives in what? Adversity. In adversity. That is why it is a waste of time. Now, there's nothing you can do to disadvantage the true church of God. Look at verse 12, Exodus 1. Verse 12. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied, and the more they grew, and the Egyptians were in dread of the children of Israel. Ah, but you're afflicting them. Why are you afraid? The more they afflicted them, the more the children of Israel did what? Multiply and grow. Somebody shout hallelujah. Jesus is building his church. And that is why I want to say that this local church can never go down. This one can never go down. Why? Because it is part and parcel of the church of Jesus Christ. Yes. Look at your Bible. It says, whoever shall injure Jerusalem shall injure himself. Zechariah 12:3. Now, what am I saying to you? I'm showing you some of the terms of reference of the Lord of the church, Jesus Christ. Number one, he builds his church. He builds his church. Number two, he defends his church. He defends his church. He defends his church. And Zechariah 12:3 is one case in point. And it shall happen in that day that I will make Jerusalem a heavy stone for all peoples. All who would heave it away will surely be cut in pieces. Have you seen it? Those who try, he has made it a very heavy what? Stone. And you want to carry it. You will break your fingers now. Yes. The thing will fall on your feet. Because it's too heavy. Praise the name of Jesus. I said, praise the name of Jesus. Matthew 16, verse 18. On this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Jesus is simply saying that there is no power of darkness that shall prevail against the church that I am building. And when we talk of the church, we are not talking about buildings. We are not talking about tents. We are not talking about places of worship. We are talking about people that believe in Christ Jesus. So you are the church. Somebody shout, we are the church. We are the church. And so when he says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against this, he's simply saying that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the people that believe in me and follow me. As master, Lord over his church, he defends his church. And I want you to know that God will defend you. Amen. I'm talking to you. Can I hear your loud shout of amen? Amen. The Bible says in Psalm 121 and verse number 7, it says, the Lord shall preserve you from all evil. the Lord shall preserve your soul. That is Psalm 121 and verse number 7. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I said hallelujah.
Amen.
The meaning is don't live in fear because you have the Lord as your defense. Somebody shout with me, the Lord is my defense. In Proverbs 18 and verse number 10, Proverbs 18 verse number 10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. Yes, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Glory to God. Number three, oh my God, what does Jesus do as Lord over his church? Number one, he builds his church. Number two, he defends his church. Number three, he reigns on earth through his church. He reigns on earth through his church. Jesus exercises mastery over the earth through his church. You remember, I took you to Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. Let's look at that verse again. It says, God has put all things under his feet. Under the feet of who? Under the feet of Jesus. God has put how many things under the feet of Jesus? All things. God has put all things under the feet of Jesus. And beyond that, God gave Jesus to be head over all things to the church. What does that mean? To the church. To the church. NIV. Head over all things to the church. NIV, please. Have you seen now? It is clearer. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church. That nobody should move the church around anyhow. In other words, for the dominion of the church on earth. He did this for the sake of the church, that the church can dominate the earth on his behalf. So he reigns on earth through his church. In other words, the church reigns on the earth through Jesus Christ. Because he has been made to be head over everything for the church. Good News Translation. God put all things under Christ's feet and gave him to the church as supreme Lord over all things. So Romans 5:17 has this to say. Romans 5 and verse number 17. Glory to God. For if by the one man's offense death reigned through the one. Have you seen it? Much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life. Where are they going to reign? In life. Through the one. Who is this the one? Jesus Christ. So we are not here as a confused lot waiting to be raptured to heaven someday because we are helpless here on earth. No, sir. No. The church is living in a prophetic season that is called in the Bible the day of his power. It is called what? The day of God's power. We are in that prophetic season now. Yes. Yes. So the church must wake up and begin to position itself in Christ to exercise dominion in the earth. To exercise dominion in the earth. That is why one of the things the enemy will fight vehemently concerning the church is what we call church growth. What is it? Church growth. If there is one thing that makes the devil shiver about the church, are numbers. What are they? Numbers. If he sees the church growing from 10, 20, to 100, 1,000, 5,000, 10,000, he doesn't like that. He doesn't like that. He doesn't like to see the church increasing in numbers. That is why when there was an explosion of numerical increase in the early church, you remember what they were told? They were slapped, they were whipped, they were beaten, and they were told not to preach anymore in the name of Jesus. They said, we don't like this name. Oh, everyone is talking about Jesus. Jesus, don't know. Shut up. Hallelujah. Amen. I said hallelujah. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you the authority to trample over scorpions and serpents and over every power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. What is that, sir? Dominion. That's dominion. Because what is in the earth? What is in the earth? Scorpions and serpents and powers of the enemy. And Jesus says to the church, I have given you the authority to silence scorpions and serpents. In other words, I have ordained you to take over. And the church will take over in our time in the name of Jesus. I said the church will take over in our time in the name of Jesus. Please, can I hear a loud shout of amen here? Children of God will be taking over every facet of industry. Yes. Every facet of the economy. Children of God are taking over to take the lead, to take charge. Not just to hide in their corners speaking in tongues and singing songs like, if you can enjoy your kumamba, hey, you shut up. Now, because of time, can we move quickly? What else does Jesus do as Lord over his church? Number one, he builds his church. Number two, he defends his church. Number three, he reigns on earth through his church. Number four, and now this is important. He nourishes his church. He nourishes his church. He nourishes his church. Now, the Apostle Paul put it this way in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 29 to 30. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 29 to 30. For no one ever hated his own body, but nourishes, hear this, and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. What does Jesus do with the church? He nourishes and cherishes it. That is what Jesus does. In other words, beloved, Jesus will take care of you. Because I told you that the church is not a building. The church is the believers all of us put together, regardless of our denominational affiliations, if we are born again, we are the church of God. And the Bible says that God nourishes and cherishes the church. That means you will never be stranded another day in this life. I'm talking to you, shout a better amen. I said a better amen. I said a better amen. He nourishes and cherishes the church. Verse number 30. For we are members of his body. He is the head. We are the body. Maybe you are an eye. Most likely, maybe I'm intestines. I don't know what you like. You want what? Maybe you are a leg. Some of you are the finger. Some of you are the teeth. Probably that's why you like talking too much. The teeth. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. So anybody who wants to hurt you is hurting the bone of Jesus. Can you imagine? You remember what God told the children of Israel? He said, whoever touches you touches the apple of my eye. Yes. Somebody shout, I am untouchable. I am well nourished. I am well cared for. Yes. Let's get back to verse 29. Okay. Look at that. Zechariah chapter 2, verse number 8. For thus says the Lord of hosts, he sent me after glory to the nations which plunder you. For he who touches you touches the apple of his eye. That's Zechariah 2 and verse number 8. Now, let's get back to Ephesians chapter 5, please, and verse 29. Now, let's have this in Good News Translation. None of us ever hurt our own bodies. Is there anybody like that? Because some people do, the way they tattoo their body. Anyway, maybe it's part of decoration. Anyways, none of us ever hurt our own bodies. Instead, what do with our bodies? We feed them and take care of them, just as Christ does the church. What does Christ do with the church? He feeds the church. Can you see that God will feed you? Yes. Tell your neighbor, God will feed me. That is why, as a pastor in this church, I never have sleepless nights thinking about where will money come from? Hey, these projects, I don't have time for that nonsense. Why? Is it my church? Is it my church? We have already established it is the church of who? If it is his church, then it qualifies to be fed by him and to be taken care of by him. Glory to God. Somebody shout hallelujah. And now, you are part of his church. And what does he do with his church? He feeds it and takes care of it. In your homes, God shall feed you. He shall take care of you. I said he shall feed you. He shall take care of you. In the mighty name of Jesus. He shall make sure no sickness comes near you. No poverty comes near you. No stagnation comes near you. No rejection comes near you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Please, can I hear a louder shout of amen here? I said a louder shout of amen. Your Bible is seated. All right. Can we move on now to look at the fifth dimension of the Lordship of Jesus as we begin to wind down. Number five, Jesus, hear this, is the Lord of Lords. Jesus is the Lord of Lords. You know, we are living in a world of lords. And some of you are Lord on your own. You are big man, big mama. Yes. We have bosses, I mean presidents, the rich and the affluent. We have celebrities. All these are categories of lords. And then we have landlords. I think those are the most common lords. Landlords. Landlords. I know there are quite a number of landlords seated here. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, Jesus is Lord over all of them. Can you imagine? Because even among the lords, there are different categories of lords and levels. Others are lords at local level. For example, let's talk about chieftains. So here you have village headman. And then you have group village headman. Have you seen that? And then you have sub-chief. And then you have the TA. And then others are paramount. All the lords put together, Jesus is their Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. I said hallelujah. Amen. That is not surprising, because the Bible has already told us that every knee shall what? Bow. Of things in heaven, things on the earth, and things under the earth. So it doesn't matter where these lords are found, whether they're in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, they are all, if not by choice, they will bow by force. A day is coming when they will bow by force. I'd rather bow by choice. It's a joy to bow to him by choice. Because it says, on that day, others will be beating their chest to wish themselves dead. And they will be asking lions, lion, eat me now. Lion will be saying, no, I have no appetite. It says, every knee shall bow. Why? Because Jesus is Lord of all lords. Somebody shout hallelujah. Are you not excited that you associate with the Lord of lords? Revelation 19 and verse number 16. What does it say? And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and what? Lord of Lords. He is a King of Kings. Because there are many kings. Now, he is above all those kings. And there are many lords, and Jesus sits high above any lord you can talk about. Now, look at your Bible. Revelation chapter 17 and verse number 14. Revelation 17 and verse 14 says, these will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. Why? For he is Lord of Lords. So the difference is there that other lords have small letter L. Have you seen it? They cannot have capital letter L. There's only one with capital letter L. Lord Jesus is the Lord of Lords. In other words, the rest of the lords are smaller ones. They may be competing among themselves as to who is greater, but when all of them are compared with Jesus, they are dwarfs. And he is King of kings, and those who are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. Somebody shout, I am called, I am chosen, and I am faithful. Ask your neighbor, are you faithful? Okay, now, let's move quickly here. You can also capture Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. We've talked about that severally today. Now, let's move to the last one here so we can call it a day or a night. Point number 6, dimensions of Christ's lordship. Number 6 now, this is the final. He is Lord of all. So everything else that we may not have touched on, everything put together, including the ones we have talked about, he is Lord of all. Yes. Jesus is Lord of all. Acts 10:36. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ. There is a dash. Other Bibles will have this in brackets. He is Lord of all. This Jesus Christ we are talking about is Lord of how many? All. People, animals, spirits, everything, their Lord is Jesus. Hebrews 2 verse number 8. Hebrews 2 verse number 8. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. What has God done? He has put how many things? All things in subjection under the feet of Jesus. And there's an explanation. He says, for in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. Children of God, I'm talking to you. Do you understand the explanation? He says, nothing has been left to have not been put under Jesus. Everything has been put under him. Somebody shout hallelujah. He is Lord of all. Those of you that have got landlords, he is Lord of your landlord. Yes. He is Lord over all. So, let's conclude by receiving counsel from the prophet of God. Counsel number 1. Count it a gracious privilege to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's counsel number 1 you are receiving from the Lord tonight. Count it a gracious privilege, not just a great privilege, but a gracious privilege to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Never take that for granted. Never take that lightly. You shouldn't take it lightly. That you can relate with such a great Lord is a rare privilege. Because you know it's not everyone on earth who has had this privilege of relating with the Lord of Lords. Number 2, yield the totality of your being to his lordship. Yield the totality of your being to his lordship. And I think that is what Apostle Paul means by saying what he tells us in Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 10. Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 10. And Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. Maybe in the interest of time, let's read Galatians 2 and verse number 20. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. Have you seen that? It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. He says, it is no longer I who live. That's amazing. He says, it is Christ living in me. I have surrendered all to him. I have no priorities of my own. No. I have no tests of my own. The test I have is the test of the Lord. The appetite I have is the appetite of the Lord. The values I have are the values of the Lord. It is no longer I who lives. My own life was lost. The life you see manifesting in me is that of Christ. This is a place we need to reach, even by our understanding of the Lordship of Jesus. Somebody shout hallelujah. Let him reign in your life. Let him take full control of the affairs of your life. Allow him to guide you. Allow him to lead you. Allow him to gain mastery over your life. Many have made him their savior, but not many have made him their Lord. Some have only given him lordship over some pockets and assets of their lives, but there are others that they are still in full control of. Some have only given him their heart, but not their bank account. They are in charge of their pockets. Jesus, take over my heart. Leave my marriage with me. That is why there is abuse of one another. There are all kinds of things happening in marriages. Others, the business is still in their hands, not in the hands of Jesus. So they can stay away from church anytime because of business. They have not given the lordship of their business to Jesus. They are still in charge. They are still in charge. And they are surprised why their lives are scattered. Listen to me. Nothing should be more important in your life than Jesus Christ. Nothing should be more important in your life than Jesus. Because there is nothing greater than him. Hallelujah. If you arrive at Jesus, if he was a destination, then that's the end of your trip. There's nowhere else to go. Peter said what? He said, where will we go? Because you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Where can we go? We have come to know and believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Where else do we go? We don't have anywhere else to go. We must surrender ourselves unreservedly to his reign in our lives. In our decisions, in our values, in our priorities. We must surrender wholly, wholeheartedly, unreservedly to his reign in our lives, in our decisions, in our values, in our priorities. If you understand what I'm saying, shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lastly, my counsel is number three, if you like. Depart from iniquity. Live a holy life and serve him with fear and trembling. All that put together is loaded. Depart from iniquity. Live a holy life and serve him with fear and trembling. Never joke with the work of God, please. Never get used to serving God. It's not a hobby. Being a servant of God in the church is not the same as being an accountant at your workplace. You don't need to be holy to deliver on your assignment as an accountant. You can beat your wife the whole night, drink the whole night, womanize the whole night, and go to the office tomorrow morning. You still balance your trial balance. It will balance. Trial balance what? Will balance, and you will produce brilliant account. You can even receive an award for beating the deadline in record time. Yes. As an accountant. But you can't live the same way as a child of God who must serve God. Is it making sense? You can't live the same way and expect that you're going to be at peace with God. It never works, my friend. You must commit to departing from iniquity, living a holy life, and serving God, serving Jesus with fear and trembling. Somebody shout hallelujah. Please get the following scriptures very quickly. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 19 to 22. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 19 to 22. We'll be reading verse 19 there. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20. And Psalm 2, verses 10 to 11. Psalm 2. Verses 10 to 11. I'll come again. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 19 to 22. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20. And Psalm 2, verses 10 to 11. I'm reading only one verse, and then I'll be asking us to rise on our feet. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands sure. I want us to know that his foundation is solid. Is it making sense? The foundation of God is what? Solid. It's solid. And it has an inscription on it. This foundation has words that have been written on it. And the words say this. Number one, the Lord knows those who are his. As you live here on earth, as you stay in the house of God, and as you run around in kingdom service, please be sure that God knows you. Because a time is coming. I still have to give you some verses anyway. Matthew chapter 7, verses, please don't move away from this, those of you that are operating the computer. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23, some fellows will be told, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, for I never knew you. And yet they said to him, we prophesied in your name, we cast out demons in your name, and we did many, not just few, not sporadic, scant here and there, miracles. No, we did many wonders. Many wonders in your name. And yet, he will say to them, I never knew you. And so this inscription is an important reminder. Because it is on his foundation. It says, the Lord knows those who are his. I hope you are known. I hope I am known. How do you become known? Make sure you are born again. and having been born again, live a holy life. Then you are assured that you are known. Number two, there is another inscription there. It says, let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Let everyone who names the name of Christ, everyone who mentions the name of Christ, depart from iniquity. Let us rise on our feet. Please, just briefly before we go, appreciate the Lord for the teaching of his word, everyone. Lift your voice. Appreciate the Lord for the teaching of his word. Appreciate the Lord for the teaching of his word. How many are lifting their voices? You are watching us online. Lift your voice. Let's celebrate God for the teaching of his word. Give him thanks. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give him adoration. Yes. Lift your voice, everyone. Give him thanks. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give him adoration. Bless him, everyone. Give him thanks. In Jesus' precious name. Now, in Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 10, Philippians 3 and verse number 10, I want to know him. Yes. I want you to lift your voice to God and say, Lord, help me to know Jesus. Father, help me to know Jesus. Please lift your voice and pray. Yes. If there is one thing we desire, one thing we must cry for, is to know Jesus. Now that the Lord bless you, may he give you peace, success and prosperity, breakthroughs on every side. In the mighty name of Jesus, your life shall never be the same. You are changing levels. God is taking you higher. He shall feed you. He shall nourish you. He shall take care of you. In the name of Jesus, all is well with your life. I said, all is well with your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Please, you believe that, shout amen 3 times.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Psalm 23 and verse number 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.